Dr. Hermano Igo Krebs will share with us his newest work on the topic, you know, how can we repair a broken brain with movement therapy approach. He joined MIT's Mechanical Engineering Department back in 1997, where he's principal research scientist and lecturer in Newman Laboratory for Biomechanics and Human Rehabilitation. He also holds an affiliate position as an adjunct professor at the University of Maryland School of Medicine, Department of Neurology, at the Division of Rehabilitative Medicine. He's also a founder of Interactive Motion Technologies, a Massachusetts-based company commercializing robot technology for rehabilitation. His goal is to revolutionize the way rehabilitation medicine is practiced today by applying robotics and information technology to assist, enhance, and qualify and quantify rehabilitation. I can't wait to hear the news.
No, thank you. One of the things that MIT always asks me to disclose is our conflict of interest. As Renata mentioned, I'm one of the founders, and I have equity in a company that licensed the technology from MIT and commercialized that. So we have started to work in this area of rehabilitation robotics in 1989. And one of our goals, looking to the population, aging of the population, we see that if you would look here to the, this is data from the UN of people over 65 years of age, if you look here on the yellow curve, this represents Japan, blue Europe, and red the United States. And what we see is that with the baby boomers, we'll have a tremendous increase on the aging population. We'll go from 14% to over 22%. If you were in Japan, by the time my grad students would be retiring, there will be essentially 38% of the population will be over 65 years of age, and in Europe, close to 30%. Even when you take in consideration the developing world, and here I'm showing India, you would see that the population over 65 is going to grow at a very fast pace. And if we take in consideration China, which I'm not plotting here, but because of the one-child policy, by 2050, China will be between Europe and Japan in terms of aging. So what we started doing in 1989 was trying to start developing technology to help clinicians deliver therapy. Now, this technology and these ideas to develop technology to help the clinician deliver therapy didn't came in a vacuum. What we learned in the 70s and 80s was that the concept that the adult brain was hardwired was incorrect. Neuroscience taught us that actually the brain was plastic, that new connections could be created or existing connections reinforced. So under this perspective, we started developing this concept. And here is one of the examples that for me was very important to convince me about this idea. This is data from a colleague from Kansas City, Randy Nudo, where he shows that in a group, he separated the monkeys in two different groups. What he showed is that if he, let me get here, what he did show is that he mapped the area representing the hand, and he made a lesion in this part of the brains of the monkeys. And he separated them in two groups. One group that received no rehab, he put them back in the environment. And they were able to keep doing their things to some extent, using the unimpaired hand. And what you see is that here you see the lesion, and you see that the area representing the hand did shrink. It's smaller than was before. But the other group, he created a kind of a form of therapy for the monkeys. They had to press a lever with a very hard one with their unimpaired limb, and they had to retrieve from very small holes that would open when he pushed down that lever, they had to retrieve small raisins or other food elements. And what he did see is that the area responding to the brain did increase, not only did not shrink, but actually started to be represented in areas that were not represented before. So this is a very good example of brain plasticity. So now the concept that then we start developing was robots to assist the clinicians deliver therapy. Again, our goal was not to create assistive technology. So somebody is very active, they have a stroke. What happens is that we are trying to get this person back so they could go back to the environment without the need of any technologies. If we are not successful, then we will need assistive technology, like my pair of glasses, to help the person be able to be independent, be able to have some of the activities of daily living. But that's not what we are focusing, and not also in prosthetics. What we are focusing was creating technology to help the clinician deliver therapy. And this area has been growing very fast in the space of robotics. So I did a very unprofessional way. I took a Google Scholar and I ran per year words, keywords, rehab robotics, service robotics, and arm prosthesis. And we had heard a lot about arm prosthesis that had grown somehow in the media, particularly after the Gulf Wars. But what we have seen is that if you actually count the number of papers and the growth in the area, you'd see that the area of rehab robotics is one of the fastest growing areas among researchers around the world. So, and not only they are growing, now very large companies are entering this field. And with a very large expectation of very fast growth. So just to give you an idea, all these companies in red that are very large companies are now heavily involved in this field. Toyota, for example, bought the division of Sony that made that small dog, Aibo. Now it's a division of Toyota, and all they do is the development of rehab robots that are presently being tested in Japan and will take a few years until we see them here. But not only Toyota or Honda or Yaskawa or Teijin, all Japanese companies, but also large Korean companies and also a few very large American companies. Now, we had done enough trials that since 2010, the American Heart Association endorsed the use of this technology for stroke for the upper extremity. So UE represent upper extremity, LE represent lower extremity. And they gave us the best possible evidence for the outpatient, giving us class one, which is the best possible evidence that you can obtain, and class 2A for the inpatient, in part because today is very difficult to run studies here in the US. Again, we are comparing robotic therapy with usual care. We are trying to see if we can deliver better care than what was traditionally a compassionate-based treatment. And not only we did show that we can have better outcomes, but we also did show that at least in a socialized medicine system like the VA, the cost goes down. So not only you have a benefit, but the cost also goes down. So in a sense, there is no need to do a cost-benefit analysis. You have a benefit and the cost went down for the VA. Again, this was valid for the VA system. Because of that, the VA now is trying to figure out not to do this as a research, but actually make this standard clinical practice. And because we were able to show better care and lower cost, the National Health Service in the UK got very interested. And presently, we are past already half point of a very large trial between 720 and 800 stroke patients, where actually they want to see how much it costs in the British system. This is a trial running 16 hospitals organized in four hubs with three satellites in each hospital. Now, for the lower extremity, the picture is not as good. These are the most common devices here in the in the US. Primarily, they are exoskeletal-based devices. And what we did see is that when you look to the VA guidelines, and you can pay attention to number 7 for stroke care, they say there is no sufficient evidence supporting the use of robotic device during gait training in patients post-stroke. They gave us D, which is the worst that you could get it. Now, let me try to say perhaps why. So here is what is a comparison of what is usual care. You see a patient and the therapist trying to get the patient to give one step at a time. Slowly, steady, balancing the patient, initiate one step at a time. And then this was considered the gold standard here in the US. Body weight treadmill training, free therapist, one shifting the weight of the person from one side to the other, two on the floor moving their legs. And this actually not very ergonomic, and therefore technology look a great idea. The problem is that with many things that are based on compassionate care, when they are tested, the results are surprising. And it did show no advantage on the second form of treatment compared to the first one. So you have three therapists delivering body weight treadmill training compared to one therapist delivering the conventional, and the outcomes were the same. So the part of the reason, and because of that, there is quite some backlash for the low extremity, not the upper extremity, by very prominent physicians and therapists. So here perhaps is where we could do better. The reason we were successful on the upper extremity is that we took ideas from neuroscience and tried to develop them further. While the other approach would be to assume that what therapists were doing were very well grounded and based on evidence and science. And turns out that primarily was very good techniques, but primarily based on compassionate care. And unless we test that, it becomes very difficult for us to demonstrate actually validity. Now, the nice opportunity, and I believe we could do the same thing also for the lower extremity, is that not only we can now redo what was done for the lower extremity, now based on concepts of neuroscience, we can also use the robots themselves as great biomarkers to guide us. So this is an example for the upper extremity that we did for Johnson & Johnson, Janssen, where we follow a large number of stroke patients with both clinical outcomes and robotic assay to evaluate these patients. And the results that we got, and I'm just going here to move a little forward, says that if J&J or Janssen would have any drug to test for stroke, they could have a 70% reduction on the number of patients needed to demonstrate the efficacy if they would be using a robotic assay. And again, from their perspective, they are happy to have this assay. And in case the trial would be negative, they don't need to go all the end to the 800 patients that is normally involved in a typical study. With around 200 to 240, they can stop the trial and complete that. Now, so for the upper extremity, if we look to those conditions that would determine if a modality is valid, it's not to say that the modality doesn't have a benefit. It's to say that the modality has more benefit compared to the usual care in the United States. What we see is that for the upper extremity, we had shown that the upper extremity robotics, when done as an interactive intervention, can lead to better gains than usual care or other modalities, as in the VA study where there was a follow-up of 6 months after the intervention. We can show that the gains persist for a long period. We can also show that they generalize for some in within some space to untrained tasks. And we also can show that the cost benefit, they are as good or better than other modalities. Now, for the low extremity, I'm optimistic that we will be there also in very short order, but presently we are not there. And again, I think part of the reason is that we jump to a conclusion instead of building it from the science perspective. And with this, I believe that very soon, not only for the upper extremity, but also for the lower extremity, we'll be able to, if not repair a broken brain, at least improve significantly the outcomes beyond what would be natural recovery. Thank you.